Son of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. So there are a lot of joys in the work that I do, but one of the greatest is hearing from people that this Sunday service, this gathering, made a difference in their lives. And people will come and they'll say, you know, I've had the worst week. In every aspect of life, I felt like I wasn't enough as a parent, professionally, in all that I'm doing. I just felt like I was falling short, and one stress led to the next, and I just felt depleted. But I came to church and gathered with this community that means so much to me, and your words and the gospel somehow filled me up and gave me strength and recharged my battery so I could go back out into the world. Thank you. And it's wonderful to hear. And there are Sundays where that message is pretty easy to come by, and then there's other Sundays that aren't quite as easy. And I wonder if Jesus had some of those same moments of reflection of some of his messages, some of his days being much easier than others. This chapter came after the feeding of the 5,000, then we had the feeding of the 4,000. All of those people in wonder at who this person is that filled them until their stomachs were filled with leftovers, who went from there and healed people. How wonderful must it have felt to take somebody who is blind or lame or has leprosy and not only make them well that nobody else in the world could do, but also restore them to their community, to reconcile them to God who made them. Wonderful gift. But then there's Sundays like this Sunday, where I imagine it was much more difficult for Jesus. It certainly was a lot more difficult for those that followed behind. In today's gospel, Jesus is asking, realizing this is about the halfway point, we're starting to head towards the cross. He realized that people are getting quite excited about this man who can do things they've never seen before. But he's channeling himself as well as his followers to where this is leading. And so he asks his followers, who do they say that I am? Well, some think you're John the Baptist. Some think you're a prophet like Elijah. You think that I am? And Peter's so proud of himself. He raises his hand and he gets the answer right, at least in his own mind. It's right. You're the Messiah, the anointed one. And then Jesus goes on about what that might mean. The fact that meant that he would have to suffer. Eventually he would die and rise again. You can hear Peter's heart break. This was not what Peter signed up for. Peter dropped everything. He was supposed to take care of his mother-in-law, and he went home and had to tell his wife, I quit my job so that I can follow this man. But this man's going to take down Rome. This man is the great one, the one we've been waiting for, the one that will restore Jerusalem to its glory. He had a mother-in-law. He might have had parents to take care of, but he dropped everything because there was something about this man that he believed would change the world. So to find out that this was going to end with this man dying. And Peter was pretty comfortable being a few steps behind Jesus, who was always out there. And now, what would happen after he was no longer there? This was not what he signed up for. This was not how it was supposed to end. So he pulls Jesus and he says, this can't be it. Jesus has to tell him, this is the way that it's got to be. And not only that, but if you want to follow, you need to be willing to sacrifice as well. You need to be willing to lay your life down, to take up your cross, to live a sacrificial life. This isn't going to be all glory. Oh, it'll end in glory, but it'll have a cost. Peter's not sure what to do with this. Now that we're that sure what to do with this, it's a difficult message. Easier to hear about how much God loves us, which is in fact absolutely true. But God loves us, as we've heard before, enough to not let us stay where we are, to continue to challenge us to be more, to be the body of Christ in a fuller representation to a world in desperate need of it. So what does it look like? Taking up that cross. There are a few valiant examples that are really heroic, that that we certainly celebrate this year. We celebrated the 50th anniversary of Jonathan Daniels, a VMI graduate who really did lay down his life for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of Ruby Sales. In 1965, he had been deciding what to do with his life. He felt a call to ministry. He graduated from VMI, was studying at Harvard, and then decided he wanted to be an Episcopal priest. So he went to seminary up in Cambridge. And then he heard the message of an inspiring man named Martin Luther King, who was calling impassioned followers of the gospel, people willing to carry their cross, to come down to Alabama, and to fight against injustices taking place there. So he did. He spent a couple months down there. He was jailed for standing up for against these unjust practices. And then after going through not being allowed to, or being allowed to escape from jail or to leave jail, but staying the full length of time as a show of his commitment, he was released. And a few of them decided to go down the road to get a couple cans of Coke. And as they go, they saw somebody blocking one of the only open storefronts for people of color and whites alike. And they saw a man with a gun. And as he raised it towards this 17-year-old black woman, he dove in front of her, pushed her down, and took the bullet himself and died. He laid down his life. Some 50 years later, the woman had dedicated her life to being an example of what Daniels had done for her. She went to the same seminary that he went to. She started in Washington, D.C., a homeless shelter that bears his name. Martin Luther King said he'd never seen a more compelling example of laying down one's life for the gospel. And lives were changed, minds were changed, hearts were opened up, people grew together because of his example. This week we celebrated Constance and her companions, a story dear to me because my mom worked at the cathedral in Memphis where this took place, where there were about 30,000 people in Memphis at the time of the yellow fever. 20,000 fled, and of those 10 that remained, I think 80% were infected. Constance and her companion stayed faithfully amongst with other clergy and other members of her sisterhood, and they ministered, even though they meant that it would probably lead to at least becoming infected and probably death. And with Constance, it did lead to death. Much like those who went across the world to combat Ebola, they stood their ground in that same church, that same cathedral, with two-thirds empty pews at the time my mom worked there, also because of that example, felt compelled to seek justice when Martin Luther King wanted to march in Memphis, and they began there at that cathedral, and it cost them two-thirds of their congregation, still dwindled from combating the yellow fever some decades before. But that's what discipleship looks like. That's all. But what does it look like for us in Fauquier County? That's the hard question. Somebody says it's really easy to be a Christian in America today. I think that's untrue. I think it's never been harder. I think it's hard because of our comfort. Because nobody stopped us on the way and tried to talk us out of coming here today. Nobody stood at the door. No lives were at risk in coming here to worship. So sometimes I think we forget the cost that we're called to. And Fauquier County is an incredible place. We've fallen in love with it. I love the people to a person. It's a wonderful, wonderful place. But it is a very Christian county, and therefore should look like the kingdom of God. So as Christians, as the body of Christ, we have to ask ourselves, what does carrying our cross look like in Fauquier County and beyond, but in Fauquier County? When people come into this county, do they see every single person who works here cared for? I think we have work to do. We have four or five grocery stores. We have a hospital. We have a Walmart. We have fast food. We have services at our disposal, which means we have a whole lot of labor that make probably much less than $10 an hour, and we have very little place for them to be able to live. I get phone call after phone call. I wish many hear the number of phone calls of people who can't afford to live here, who whose cars are breaking down because they live two counties over to be able to come here and make not enough money, who work on an inflexible schedule because they're at their employee's disposal, but who don't have health insurance, and who every little hiccup causes them to fall farther down. We have an incredible county with incredible hearts, and we can do better. We can make this look like the kingdom of God. I had a meeting with a person who's trying to make sure that every four-year-old in this county is given the opportunity for preschool that could transform their lives and allow them to invest from kindergarten on in the educational systems that we have to offer. And she, with tears in her eyes, talked about having to say, no, we're full. Putting a four-year-old on a waiting list, meaning that they might not ever be able to catch up with their peers. And to hear that a church wants to make a difference in that, that wants to partner with other churches so that we might look a little bit more like the kingdom of God, that brought more tears. We are blessed. But we claim to be Christians. Desmond Tutu, during the height of apartheid, those people gathered closest to him, he asked them, he said, if it was unlawful to be Christian, how quickly could a case be made against us? Again, he would say that again and again. If it was unlawful to be Christian, how quickly could they put a case up against us? We are St. James Episcopal Church. We are the body of Christ. We are Christians in Fauquier County. How quickly could they put a case against us that we are indeed Christians, convicted in our faith, ready to build the kingdom of God, right outside these doors. Amen.